Good morning, everyone. I think it's 9 o'clock, at least in Delft, it's 9 o'clock. Welcome all to the second day of this SmartThings training school. So today we will move from presentation and writing to concrete, to the real material. Four lectures today, so I will give the first one, which will be on a fracture of concrete. Then we'll give 2 hours, then Nana Lukovic will take over, more to upscaling, to the structural part. And in the afternoon, we will have 2 other sessions on microscopy and non-destructive testing. So today, cracking of concrete. Let's see, here are my slides. So what are we going to talk about? The content of this lecture of this morning is different types of damage. We will look at that. We will look at recognizing cracks, mechanical properties of different concretes we will discuss. Crack propagation in concrete, and then at different scales, because it will be different sizes. And what you should learn from this lecture is, of course, how you can recognize damage. If you go to a concrete structure, you see damage. What do you see there? What was the cause of the damage? Because if you are going to repair it or implement self-healing technologies, then you should know what is the cause of the damage. Because if you don't know why you get the damage, you can also not repair it, because otherwise it will come back. So why does concrete crack? That you should know after this lecture. How do cracks propagate in the material? Where does it start? How does it go through the material? And how can we influence the cracking? So what are the things to play with to stop cracking, to let it go in a different direction? So that are the things we will discuss and you should learn from this lecture and you should know afterwards. So what causes damage in concrete in structures? Of course, loading. That's why we build a structure. It should carry a load. And then sometimes also overloading. So if you put too much load on it, then that can cause damage in your structure, in your material. Also imposed deformations. What that is, we will see later. And imposed deformations you can have on the material and on the structural level. Of course, accidental loading, impact loading can be a cause of damage. And then, of course, building errors or design errors that are also things that can give you damage in your material or your structure. Of course, loading, that's an easy one because our structures should carry load. So that's why we build them. So if you, for instance, have a beam here, which is loaded by this load. This load here, that goes too fast, I should not use my pen. So you see the tensile forces here, that is how the tensile load goes through the structure. So if you bend this beam, you have tension at the bottom here, and you have tension at the top here of the structure. And where you have tensile stresses, you can get cracks in your material. So there your material will crack. And those cracks, they should happen in a structure because that's how we design concrete structures. We put steel reinforcement at the places where we expect the tensile load. So if the concrete doesn't crack, we actually put the steel in there for nothing. So we need actually cracks in reinforced concrete. But of course, those cracks should not be too big because then our structure can be in danger. We can get durability problems. Water will enter, the reinforcement starts to corrode, and then It cannot carry if the rebars are attacked in the decrease in cross section. It cannot carry the load anymore, the structure. So that should not happen. So these cracks that we get in the flexural zone and here at the top, they should be there. So that's normal, but they should not be too big. Of course, overloading, if you load your structure too much, well, here they loaded the vehicles a little bit too much, but that can also be a problem. It is a problem for these vehicles, but it can also be a problem for your structure that you see here. So if the load is too heavy, the structure is not designed for it, it can lead to failure. Of course, in these cases, I don't think self-healing will help anymore, because it's a little bit too much damage. But unfortunately, these things happen in structures. But small damage, of course, we can still repair, and we can implement self-healing technologies in the structure to stop this damage. So the previous one was loading. So if the load is too heavy, we get damage in the structure, but we can also have imposed deformations, which can be on a structural level and on a material level. So here you see earthquakes. That's an imposed deformation. So the earth starts shaking, and that causes stresses in your structure and cracks in the structure. They deform a lot, they collapse. And also in these cases, probably self-healing would not have helped. There are self-healing technologies that can help for structural deformations in earthquake regions. And I think Ladana will discuss that in more detail in the second half of this morning. Imposed deformations on the structural level, you see some more. Of course, there's railway tracks. That's a nice one that you see often. If it gets too hot, the steel will expand, deform, and you see these nice shapes, and the train cannot use that track anymore. Also with roads, this can happen. So here you see this road after a hot summer day. It expanded too much, and at the construction joints you see the concrete just comes upwards, and that causes damage. The road cannot be used anymore. This structure here, that's early age cracking in a concrete structure that is just built. It's a part of a tunnel, so a wall on a slab, and you see here vertical cracks in the structure, because the wall wants to expand because of the heat of hydration. So it warms up, it expands, and then it shrinks. And during the shrinkage, you get these cracks, because it cannot shrink because it's connected to the slab, which is already old. And that causes these vertical cracks in this structure. And of course, if there is water at the other side, which you have often in a tunnel, if you have a tunnel under a river or under the sea, then it starts leaking and water will come in. And of course, this leakage you would like to stop. And actually, this is a very nice case where self-healing would help a lot, because you get this deformation at an early age, after 1 week, 2 weeks, age of your concrete. And then the deformation actually stops, but the crack is there. So you get not any more deformations later on. Maybe a little bit due to creep or more shrinkage, but the main deformation has stopped after 1 week. And in that case, self-healing would help if you have self-healing technology in your concrete that could block these cracks, that no water could penetrate anymore. Because then it should only work for maybe a few weeks, and then the problem is solved. So this will impose deformation on the structural level, but we can also have these on the material level. Think about force damage that you see here, force damage that can cause these pieces of material to come off. Think about corrosion, which is expansion of your rebars if they corrode. So they will expand and they will cause deformation inside the material and spoil off the concrete. We can have ASR reactions, as you see here. So the aggregates, they actually expand in the material because there's some reaction. That causes these small cracks in the structure, which causes also, it's a damage in the material, but it causes structural damage because the stiffness and the strength of the material decreases. Accidental loading can also happen. You see here some examples of bridges that got attacked by a vehicle, which is not healthy for the bridge, so that that can cause huge damage, which is also not easy to repair. Building errors can also lead to damage. Here the foundation is not well designed, and that causes this building to collapse when they were building it. This is also a tunnel section where they actually used cooling inside the structure with cooling pipes, and these cooling pipes were leaking. So they put these cooling pipes in to take out the heat of hydration, the temperature, to lower the temperature. But the cooling pipes were leaking, so when they took off the formwork, then they saw that all the concrete here was gone because the water was just flowing in the formwork there. So this is also a building error. Something went wrong in the building process and you have damage of your structure. This structure is an oil platform built in Norway. Many years ago already, but here they made a design error in one of these, or a design error between these concrete parts of the structure, where they didn't take into account some typical loading, which caused shear kind of failure in this structure. And they didn't design it well enough, so then afterwards they did simulations, final element simulations, and they could explain why it happened. But this was after it was built, they were putting it into the sea and then it collapsed completely. So it, of course, that is a huge loss of money, not only because the structure is gone, but also they cannot use the platform to extract the oil from the earth. And that causes also a lot of money each day if you cannot use it. So this is a typical example, a structure with a lot of cracks in it, and all these cracks are actually caused by the material, because the material is doing something. So all these cracks are not caused by loading, so loading that we put on the structure, but these are deformations in the material. Maybe you can help me to define what is the cause of these cracks. So we can go along them from A to what's the last one? M. We can cluster them already. A, B, C are kind of similar cracks. Anyone knows what causes the cracks A, B, C? Don't forget to unmute when you start speaking. Yeah.
Reinforcement corrosion.
Which one is reinforcement corrosion?
AB.
AB? No, it's not reinforcement. It looks, it could be, this pattern could be reinforcement corrosion. That's
B looks like a spill, the tension crack due to corrosion, but A.
Actually, because L, so we can go through them randomly, L is actually reinforcement corrosion. So this is indeed where the reinforcement is. Reinforcement starts to corrode, expand, and it pushes off this one. It looks similar to B. So you're right, B could have been reinforcement corrosion, but ABC is actually something different. It's I can help. It's early age settlement of the concrete. So it's very fresh state. They didn't compact it well enough. So and then you get settlement over the reinforcement. So just when it starts reacting, when it starts hydrating, getting some stiffness and strength, it still settles, it goes over the reinforcement, and that causes these cracks and this one. And the same with C, that's also settlement. So it goes from the thin part, the concrete goes into the thick part, and that causes a crack here. Because you get some settlement there over this small edge, and that causes a crack. Then we go to D, E, and F. Any idea what causes this? That's also the same mechanism.
I think it looks like due to the shrinkage, I guess.
Yes, due to shrinkage, but when? Can you determine when that would happen? At what age of the material?
Within 24 hours or for then before the final setting time.
Yeah, this is indeed also early age, so the first day, let's say. So it's evaporation of the water out of the material because I didn't cure it well enough. Yeah. So and then you get plastic shrinkage of your material if you don't cure it. So if you don't put curing compound or a layer of water or a plastic sheet or something, you have to cover your material, especially during the first days. Otherwise, your water will evaporate from the top, and that will cause these shrinkage of the material at the surface, which causes these cracks, which can be random or follow the reinforcement or diagonal to the reinforcement. So all these types of crack happen. So DEF, then we go to G and also H is due to the same mechanism. Any idea? Well, you saw this already in my previous slides where I showed the structure of the cracks.
Is it because of thermal cracking or difference between the young concrete and the old concrete which causes shrinkage cracks?
Yeah, that's true. This is thermal cracking. Indeed, this is a very thick structure, so it heats up a lot due to temperature. So it wants to expand a lot, and this is a wall on top of a slab. So the wall expands, and it's restrained by the slab. So that causes actually compression in the wall, which is no problem. But at some point, it has to cool down again. And if it cools down, because it has to be the same temperature as the environment in the end, so it cools down again and then it's going to shrink. And it's still connected to the slab. And in the meantime, the stiffness increased and the strength increased. But during this cooling down, we get tensile stresses in the wall. So in this direction, tensile stresses. Oh, it's difficult to see for the camera. These tensile stresses, they cause these vertical cracks. And at the edge of the structure, because it wants to bend a little bit there, we get horizontal cracks. So these are typical cracks, thermal cracks in the structure, which happen after 1 week, 2 weeks age after casting. So you get these cracks. Then we have I. What could be I? They look similar to G.
Yeah, is a type of a screen cage because of the some faults in the joint that doesn't the restrict the movement of the structure.
Yeah, that's true. It's shrinkage. You see, G was thermal, so in G it's due to temperature, which happens indeed after 1-2 weeks, because this is a massive structure. This is not a massive structure; it's just a thin structure, relatively thin, but it's still a wall connected to the slab. So if this wall dries out, which takes some time, which can take months or years. It dries out, it wants to shrink. It's the shrinkage is restrained by the slab. Then you get also these vertical cracks, because if the wall wants to become shorter, it cannot. Then you get tensile stress in the wall, and it causes these vertical cracks and horizontal at the sides. J and K, well, they are also due to shrinkage, due to moisture loss at the later age of your structure, which causes this crazing in the material. Then we have L and M I already discussed. That was corrosion. So corrosion of your reinforcement, which also happens later. So water has to ingress. You have to have carbonation of your concrete at the surface, or chlorides come in, which all takes years before that happens. But then your rebar starts to corrode, they expand, and they cause this cracking in the concrete, which can be vertical or horizontal. And then the final one is N. This one?
Probably, it looks like map cracking, so probably alkali-silica reactions.
Yeah, that's true. This is typical, this type of cracks for alkali-silica reactions. So it's a reaction of the aggregates with the alkali in the pore water. They react, form a gel, and then if you have water present, the gel takes up water, it swells, and that causes cracking in the material. It happens at the inside, so at the inside it starts cracking, and it also at the surface then you see these cracks. It can be a very slow mechanism, it can take 10 years or 30 years before you even see cracks, but once you see them at the surface, probably the whole structure is already cracked, and then you cannot, or it's very difficult to repair it anymore, because it reduces strength, it reduces stiffness of your structure. Usually it still can carry compressive strengths, so it's still okay if it is a structure which only carries load and not much bending. But it can also cause more durability problems, because if you have a cracked structure, also water and chlorides can enter, and that can cause more damage also to your reinforcement. So usually if you see this at the surface, then it's pretty bad with your structure, and it's not easy to fix it. Well, the next slide is just an explanation of all these things that we just discussed. So the plastic settlement, how that happens, the plastic shrinkage in the material. So you also see a cross section, you see when it happens and what you can do about it. So we will just go quickly through these slides. It's just a summary of the discussion we just had, but you have these slides for later your reference. You can look at it, and it's also good. So if you go to a structure, keep this image in mind, or take it with you if you're going to look at the structure to try to find out what the cause of damage is. Because these crack patterns, they tell you something about the mechanism that caused the damage. Plastic shrinkage was this. This is the early thermal contraction that we discussed. These vertical cracks in the structure that also starts leaking if you have water at the other side. The long-term drying, so that happens in structures also, especially at these corners, where you have a wall and this is your slab. So of course this wants to shrink, but it it cannot shrink, and then you typically get a crack here at this corner because it wants to move in two directions. This is the grazing also due to shrinkage at the surface. Corrosion, reinforcement corrosion, you probably all have seen this in structures. And this is the alkali silica or alkali aggregate reaction that we discussed. And it can take a long time before you see this damage. Well, these are some tables where you also see all of these letters again for your reference. Some causes are not in this table. One is frost damage, which can happen at the surface. So if your material freezes, your water can freeze, or you can have different mechanisms like loose spalling. Maybe Ozan will touch upon that in the afternoon. But these kind of damages also can happen due to freeze thaw or freezing of the material. Fire damage is another one. So if you heat up the inside of your structure, heat up the surface of the concrete, you can get spalling, cracking of the material. Spalling is a combination of the temperature increase, so you get a temperature gradient, and you maybe have water inside that turns into vapor, and that causes a pressure inside your structure, which can cause this heavily damaged material. So now you are experts, so you can recognize all kinds of damage in structures. So now you should tell me what this is. Who dares? What happened with this concrete? And Priya may not answer. Probably she has seen this already.
Maybe I freeze it off. Say scaling.
Scaling? That could be. It's something with freeze thaw. Yeah, that's true, but it's... I would not call this scaling. No, it's something else. So what do you see in this picture? You see here?
Probably the concrete wasn't vibrated very well. I don't know.
Not vibrated very well. Yeah, could be. So
the aggregates doesn't, probably there isn't the proper amount of filler. I don't know, actually.
And what would these lines be? You see also lines here. Any idea what that is? Well, I will help you. It's actually a very good concrete. Because the concrete in this structure, well, this looks like concrete, but usually if you look at the surface of the concrete, you don't see the aggregates. But yeah, now we know how concrete looks like, but it is just gray. But inside it maybe looks like this. But the concrete is this line here, the black line going from one side to the other. That's the concrete. And it's a confederation bridge between mainland Canada and Prince Edward Island. And what you see here is the ice in the sea there. So the ice that is crushed by the concrete. So this ice is moving from, let's say, from top to bottom here. And here, these are the pillars of the bridge. So the pillars of the bridge are crushing the ice. So that's why you see these lines here. So I can show you the next picture. So this is the bridge, and the ice is just floating under this bridge. And the ice is cracked by the bridge. So I just fooled you. So the pillars are icebreakers. So that causes this nice image, which looks like a bad concrete, but the concrete is the bridge, and that's actually good. Okay. So now a question to all of you. What is actually the strength of concrete? How do we define the strength of concrete? Who dares to tell me what that is? What is the strength of concrete? Nobody? You didn't have coffee this morning?
I think its ability of the concrete to like resist the load.
Ability of concrete to resist, yeah, that's the correct definition. And when would you, how would you test the strength of concrete? And when?
You can do like compressive strength and tensile strength and split tensile strength uh-huh. and flexural strength.
Yeah, but how, so if you look in the codes, then we call it the strength with the C values, C 30, 35. And how is that measured?
That is the compressive strength.
Yeah, that's the compressive strength. So we use the compressive strength as the strength of the concrete. And when do we measure it? By definition?
After 28 days.
After 28 days. So that's actually the definition that we take a sample of concrete. We can take a cube or a cylinder. They are a bit different. I will show you. We test it after 28 days with a certain speed, a certain machine, certain size of your specimen. And the value that we then get at 28 days, we call that the compressive strength of the concrete. So actually, it's just a definition. Eh? So strength is a definition. Am I still there? I don't see you moving anymore. Do you still hear me?
Yes, Professor.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. I didn't see people moving in my screen, so I thought maybe it was frozen. So let's see how we make concrete. So if we mix concrete, this is the simple version, images made by my former colleague Mario de Roy. So he said, well, if you add solid parts, cement, sand, gravel, put that in the mixer together with water, then you get concrete. So you mix it and then you have the simple version of the concrete. Of course, you have to put the right amounts of these solid parts and liquid parts to get a good strength. All of that you will learn on Thursday in the lectures, how to make the concrete. I will not go into that further. But this is the simple concrete. Eh? But nowadays we make concrete with much more ingredients. So we add fine particles to it, fillers, we add particles that help with hydration. We can add fibers, polymers or steel, well, not babies, but water entrainers. We can add all kind of chemicals to make it more stable, to make it more fluid, to have a faster reaction or a slower reaction. We also use recycled aggregates. So all of these components we put into concrete, and then it's more difficult to predict what strength we get. In this case, it is fairly easy. We know from experience what we get, but in this case, that's not that easy anymore. But we put all these properties to all these ingredients to improve the properties. So to get a better concrete, which is easier to handle, we got a good compaction, so all these ingredients we add to make it better. And then we're going to test the concrete. So I said we can take a cube, and if you load it, it breaks, it falls apart, and of course the maximum load that we measure, we call that the compressive strength. So this is a normal concrete, which goes pretty slow, but we can also do a higher strength concrete, in this case a cylinder. If you load it, you will see it fails more explosively. So not as slow as the previous one, so it's more a sudden failure of the material in a different way. So again, back to the testing of the concrete. So the age of testing is very important, because we measure at 28 days usually the compressive strength, but yeah, is that the strength? In the end, So here in the graph, you see this strength versus time. In the end, we get a much higher strength than at 28 days. And in the beginning, the strength is much lower. So keep that in mind, that the strength develops in time, and 28 days is just a point that we said, well, that's tested there, and we defined that as strength. So that's also important if you look at the damage in your structure. If the damage happens at early age, the strength is much lower. If the strength happens later, take into account that your strength of your material is actually much higher. So your stress that is in there that causes the cracking will be much higher than you maybe assumed. Also much higher than you take into account when you design your structure, because the strength increased, the stiffness increased. So everything is much higher at later age. And actually, you should take that also into account if you design your reinforcement. Because if you design that for the strength of 28 days and your concrete gets stronger, then maybe you also have to put somewhat more reinforcement if you put that reinforcement to lower your crack risk, because that's what you usually do. You design the reinforcement, your steel rebars, in such a way that you get a certain crack width. But if your concrete gets much stronger, so if the stress where it cracks is higher, your crack risk will also be bigger. So that's an important thing to notice. So if you're going to fracture a material, we can do that in mode 1, mode 2, or mode 3. Mode 1 is then compression and tension. So we compress something, or we pull on it in tension. We can do a shear loading, or we can do a torsion loading. So everything causes a stress in your material, which causes cracking. And well, we can do these tests in the lab, apply this load in a nice way. But in practice, in a big structure, which is loaded by different loadings, you always have a combination of everything like this. So the stress in the material in a structure is always a combination of different loading modes, and fracture will be according to that. But how does concrete actually fail? So we say we load it in compression. So if we have here a simple concrete, which is a stacking of particles on top of each other. So if we load this in compression vertically, here we support it, then the load goes from one particle to the other and to the other. So that's how the load is distributed through the material. So the load goes actually from particle to particle, and in between we have the cement paste, which is the glue to keep the aggregates together. So how does concrete then actually fail if you load it in compression? Because something is very strong in compression. If you just compress it, if you compress the aggregates, well, it can handle this compression. But if you look at this stacking of particles, if you look at this image, so if you have this vertical load, which goes from one particle to the other, this is compression load, this is compression load. Then we see we get a tensile load here in between. So if we load it, we get tensile forces in the other direction. And that's actually where concrete is not that good, because if you pull on it, it's not that strong. So here we get actually tensile force between the aggregates, and that's where a crack will start. So you load it in compression, but in the other direction, we get tensile forces, and that's how cracks develop in concrete. You also saw that in the cube when we were compressing it. We saw at the sides, we saw parts coming up. And that's because the tensile stress in at the surface there becomes too high, and the parts, they will split up. So here you see how we do a compression test on a cylinder, on a cube. So if we compress it, it will deform like this. So we got compression stress here, actually. Here at the top and at the bottom, we have a zone where we have triaxial compression, because it cannot slide along these steel plates, so it will bend like this. And actually here we get then tensile stresses. And that causes, so tensile stress in this direction, And that causes these vertical cracks to happen. So usually you get cracks which go like this, and this part will come off. That is how a concrete cube will fail if you do a compression test. So here you see, this is the concrete cube after compression test, not failed completely, but you see here these cracks that I just was drawing also. So this is how the concrete with normal rigid steel plates at the top will fracture. If you now put in between your concrete and your machine, if you put there some sheets of Teflon and some grease in between, so you put them here at the top and the bottom, so then you avoid this sliding. So then your specimen doesn't deform like this, but it can more deform just horizontally if you compress it. And what you see then is that you get vertical cracks, inclined cracks like this that develop in the material, which fails it in a different way. So if you reduce that friction at the surface, you have pure compression, and then you get more or less pure splitting with some friction angle of about 21 degrees to be precise. So that causes your material to fail in that way. So in this case, you don't have pure compression because you have a triaxial compression zone at top and bottom. So you get tensile stresses here. Here you have more pure compression, and then you get splitting in the other direction, which causes the crack to open. So that makes also a difference between a cube and a cylinder. So this would be the cube, where you have indeed the triaxial compression zone at the top and the bottom. So there you have to get no failure, but your failure happens in this zone where you have the tensile stresses. If you have a cylinder or a prism, which is higher, so then your triaxial compression zone is again at the top and the bottom, but here in the middle, your specimen can easily fail. So cracks might start here, and then they just split through the specimen like this. So this specimen will fail in a different way, which also means that the cylinder strength that you would measure has a lower value than the cube strength. So some countries, the cube is the standard, and some countries, the cylinder is the standard. But there is a difference between them. The cylinder strength is usually lower. And here you see a graph to compare them. And also in the standards, you see correction factors, how to correct the strength if you test with a cylinder or a cube, how you can relate them to each other. So what's also important if you look at strength of concrete, how does this shape actually look like? So if we test it, we can plot a stress strain curve that you see here. And of course, first the stress goes up, we reach a maximum. If we keep increasing the load, your specimen will fail here. What if you do it deformation controlled or strain controlled with a machine? I will tell you after the break how we do that. Then you can also measure what is after the maximum load. So you slowly keep deforming the specimen, and you can measure this, this softening branch of the material. So what happens if we make a stronger concrete is that first the stiffness, which is the slope of the curve, the E modulus, that will increase. So if you make the material stronger, then this the slope will become higher. So the stiffness increases if you make the concrete stronger like this. So if you go from B15 to B60, of course the maximum load will become higher. That's why we call it a higher strength. But after the maximum load, the drop is a bit steeper. So here you see it's not that steep. But if the load is higher, the drop is steeper. And that's also important. We will come back to that a little bit later. But keep in mind, the slope is higher if you go to higher strength, so which means the stiffness is higher. And also the descending branch, if you go to higher strength concrete, is steeper, and we have for that a more brittle behavior. I will come back to that in a few minutes when we talk about cracks in the material. If you go to a lightweight concrete, then we see the opposite, then the stiffness actually becomes lower. So if you go from a normal concrete to the lightweight, which is the dashed line, so then we see that the stiffness is lower because the lightweight aggregate particles are actually much weaker. They have a lower stiffness and they determine then the stiffness of the material. Keep that in mind also if you are going to design self-healing particles, capsules that you put in. They could be weaker than aggregates, which means that also your stiffness of the material becomes lower than if you add them to the concrete. And that could also have an effect on the strength and of the post-heat behavior maybe. And the way the material cracks. So if we test the strength of the concrete, we have to load it with a certain speed. So if we load it faster, so if we increase the strain rate, so how fast we apply the strain, then our strength actually becomes higher, both in tensile loading or in compression loading. So we can get up to 8 times higher strength if you compare a dynamic to the static strength. So if you load it very fast, you get a higher strength of your material. And if you load it very slow, so this is the opposite, if you do the very slow increase of the loading, then we get not only the loading, but also creep effects, which means it goes much slower and during the process of loading, it will already deform much more, which actually reduces the strength a bit. You see, this is the strength with a normal speed. And if I go to a slower speed, then maybe I only have 90% of my strength if I do this loading slow. Remember, if you load a structure in practice, often the loading is very slow. So you put load on it and not that fast as in the machine. At least part of the loading is very slow, especially the dead weight, which is always there, which is a slow loading. So that also causes creep and might reduce the strength a bit. You can also do cyclic loading. So number 5, the dashed line is the normal loading where you measure the post-peak behavior. But if you do cycles, so if you do cycles with a very small load, so only maybe 20% of the load, then the deformation just goes back the same as you applied it. If you go a little bit higher, so here to 3, you already cause some micro cracks in the material. And if you unload them, so you will see you have some permanent deformation because you made already some damage. If you go further, almost to the peak load, to 4, if you then unload, you see my permanent deformation is even more. But you can also do loadings in the post-peak regime. So go via this one, and then unload, and then you end up here. And if you unload and reload, you always end up at this envelope that you would get if you do just a continuous test. So you always end up there with some deviation because you create some damage in the unloading and loading process. What is now the strength in practice? So what do we measure in practice? You see number A is a strength of a cylinder if you would make it in the lab. So at 28 days we are here, we have 100% of the strength. And I already said, if your material ages, it will become stronger. But if you look at cylinder B, which is actually a cylinder, a core, that is taken from practice, from a slab, which was pretty well cured, you see that the strength of this cylinder is lower at 28 days. And also it will not increase that much. So It's the same concrete, but put in practice in a real structure. So you see, in practice, the strength will be lower. C is the same, similar core, but then tested under wet conditions, which will reduce the strength even further. And D and E are also from practice, same concrete, but then the slab was not cured well. So then you get some drying at the surface, maybe some micro cracks already during the process. So you see, you maybe reach all, at 28 days, you reach only, 65% of the strength that you would get from your sample that you made in the lab. So take that also into account, that the strength of the material in a structure, it still increases in time, but it might be lower than your material that you nicely make in the lab, cure nicely, and test in that way. Well, in concrete, we also have a size effect. We apply concrete. We can look at concrete at all different levels, from very small, the crystal structure, to the real structure in practice. And all these size scales, so you see some of them here. So your material is heterogeneous, but the heterogeneity changes at all levels, which cause mechanisms at all levels that can cause damage. This is Marcel van Vliet. He did, already many years ago, a size effect study in our lab. So he tested samples very small to meters tall. He made these dog bone samples that he loaded in tension to see how the strength would change from the small specimen to the large one. And of course, the strength changes. A lot of conferences about size effect, how the strength changes, what the mechanism is. And Bajant, one of our famous professors, he developed the size effect law. There are even more laws than this one, but they are in a way similar, that they say, if you plot the stress of the strength of the material here, and this is the size of the material, so if you increase the size, your strength of your material will decrease. So that's the most important. So that you should remember, if you have larger samples, you measure a lower strength. So then again, what is the strength of concrete? Well, I said it's just a definition. If you take a certain sample size, you measure the strength at a certain age, you get a value. But if you change the size of your sample, make it bigger or smaller, you get a different value. So strength is a definition. It's not one value. And what happens at really large sizes and what happens at really small sizes? There are big debates on it. Should this curve be like this, or should it be like this, or maybe here like this, or like this? I will not discuss that today, but there are conferences on it where people fight over that, what is really happening at small and large scale. So we looked at concrete in compression, but if you load it in tension, so if you take a sample, you pull on it, then you will see that you can also measure a curve like this. So up to a maximum, and then you open it further, you see a descending curve. So this you can call the tensile strength, and this is then you measure here your deformation, which is your crack opening. So you can look at it like this. This bar, I load in tension, and at some area I will get a crack in the material, and this area, well, it just stays elastic, maybe has some micro cracking already, some small cracks in the material like this. But if you keep increasing the deformation, this part will actually unload. So this is where I measure the deformation B. So B goes to here, and then it goes back. Because here I don't have a main crack. At location A, I get the localization of the crack. That's where my crack happens in the sample. So there I can measure the crack opening, how it fills. So that's important, that you get localization of the crack somewhere. Somewhere the crack will happen, and there your deformation increases. That's where you can measure crack opening. And at the other part of the sample, maybe you have some micro cracks, but it will just elastically deform back. And maybe you have some permanent deformation, because you maybe end up here. And this is then the permanent deformation due to the micro cracks. But here it will really form a crack and your specimen will open. Well, then there are different models to take that into account, this behavior in finite element simulations. So one is the Hillebrand fictitious crack model, where you can schematize it like this. So your material has a certain stiffness, E modulus, a certain strength. And then if you load it further, if you open the crack further, you can measure a slope like this, which we call the softening behavior. And then we can look at the area under this curve. And that we call GF, the fracture energy. So this is the energy to make a crack in the sample. If you load it in tangent, to make this crack, I need this much of energy to load the sample, to create that crack. And this, these values, so the stiffness, the strength, and the GF, the energy, you can load into a finite element tool to do the simulations. But how does this actually work? How does this crack happen? Well, it's not one straight crack, because our material is heterogeneous. It has aggregates, it has pores, porosity, it has already maybe micro cracks. So a crack that develops will not be a straight crack, but it will deviate from the crack path. Especially when you have aggregates, you get crack deflections. If you have porosity, maybe the crack stops there and will continue somewhere else. If you pull out these aggregates, yeah, they are also not nicely round, but they are angular, so the crack has to go around it, because the weakest zone is mainly this interface. And that causes also some friction if you pull them out. So that all contributes to this softening curve, to this, what we had, that the material has this shape. So that it doesn't fail here and is completely brittle, but it has this long tail and this energy under the function, under this curve, which is all related to these mechanisms, bridging, branching, blunting. All these mechanisms have an effect on that. So what happens now in different types of concrete? So if you look at normal strength concrete, if I pull it, then I first get some micro cracks. So maybe here. Here I get a micro crack at the interface, because that's the weakest link. And then if I pull further, then maybe these micro cracks starts to grow. Maybe this one grows to there, that one will continue. That one continues somewhat further, joins here, that goes there, there. And then maybe this one goes there, and then it goes like this. So in the end, I have a region of micro cracks propagating to the material, and then of course your material will fail. So these cracks will grow in a normal strength concrete. What happens if I go to a, well, and then I can draw the curve here for a normal strength concrete. Oh, that was the end of my tablet. So this is the curve I get for a normal strength concrete. So if I go to a high strength concrete, so what do I try to do when I make concrete high strength? I want to improve the interface. And I want to make the matrix also stronger. So actually, I'm creating a material which has equal strength of aggregates, interface, and matrix. So they all have the same strength, roughly. That would be the optimum. So then if I pull it, I have a homogeneous material. And in a homogeneous material, the crack starts somewhere and just goes to the other side. So it goes through the aggregate to the interface because I don't have any differences anymore. So I get one straight crack. And if I have one straight crack, it's much more brittle because all these micro cracks, they contribute to the energy that I have to use to make the crack. So if I make concrete high strength, of course, as I said, the stiffness is higher, the strength is higher. But then what happens at the peak? Oops, the curve goes down straight. Because I don't have all these micro cracks that contribute to the energy. So by making it high strength, I make it stronger, I increase the stiffness, but it becomes very brittle. So that's also important to remember if you look at cracks for self-healing, if you want to heal them, that these cracks happen very sudden. They go through the material, completely through it. They don't see a difference between the components, between the interface, the aggregates, and the matrix. You just got a straight crack. Of course, this is the extreme case. Eh? You never can make the interface so strong that it's exactly the same as the aggregates, but you understand the difference. And then if you go to lightweight concrete with lightweight aggregates, then the aggregates are actually the weakest link. So your first cracks will start in the aggregates. And the interface is usually stronger because these porous aggregates are porous, and the interface, the connection between the matrix and the aggregates is stronger because you create a strong bond. So this is the weakest part in the material, so aggregates will crack. And again, if you make capsules for self-healing, you put them in concrete, maybe they are also weaker than the normal aggregates and your concrete, so then maybe also your crack starts in there. Which could be good for self-healing, because maybe your healing agent has to come out. But then afterwards, these cracks will join up and they will crack the sample. And then the curve is like this. You maybe can get a similar strength, but the deformation at peak load is usually higher than the normal strength concrete. And then mostly the post-peak behavior will be also lower, like this, because the cracks, once they develop in aggregates, they go then straight through the matrix. So this is the curve of the lightweight aggregate concrete. So this is a bit how to explain difference in different type of concrete, that cracks that grow in the material are not continuous, a straight line, but they show differences, and that's also important if you make samples to study self-healing. Think about the components that you put in. Think about the strength of the material, of the different components. What happens in there? A few more slides, and then we have a break. So what you can also do is to add the fibers to your material. So what fibers do, all different kinds of fibers you can use, they will bridge the crack. So they will keep the crack together, prevent the crack from opening, and they will actually increase this slope of the curve. So if this would be my, the part after the curve, this would be my normal concrete. If you add fibers, your curve will move to there. And the more fibers you add, the more this tail of the curve will go up because the fibers keep the crack together. And that will increase the energy that you have to put in into your sample. And it makes it less brittle. So it's also easier to do a test on fiber concrete because if you have a brittle material, it's difficult to control the test. We will see that after the break. But you can also go to the extreme, and Nadana will talk about that in more detail later. So if you add fibers in such a way, you can go from a brittle material like this to a ductile material, which actually keeps deforming. With increasing strain, you also increase the strength of the material, and you have a very deformable material with a lot of micro cracks. So you don't get only one crack, which is in the normal concrete, but with this fiber material, this strain hardening cementitious material. You get many cracks in the material, and those cracks open just a little bit. You increase the deformation and the load further, and then the next crack will fall. So that's how this concrete works, what Nana will discuss that in more detail. Well, the same you actually do with reinforcement. That's also what steel reinforcement does. Think about it as big fibers, which are continuous, and they are also there to limit the crack risk. So a crack will develop in the material, and then the steel will take over, and a new crack will develop somewhere else. So that's how reinforced concrete works. So it's just to keep the crack small and distribute the cracks. So then a summary of this lecture. We looked at the different types of damage. So different causes of damage, because the cause of damage is important. If you want to work on self-healing, so you have to understand why the damage happens and what your self-healing technique will do about it. Because if you want to fight another mechanism and your healing agent is not capable of doing that, then it doesn't work. So in this lecture, we focus on strength. What is strength of concrete? So remember that the strength will change during the age of the concrete, and it's not just one value. And how does a concrete crack? So it starts at the weakest link in the material, which is usually the interface, but can also be the aggregates if you go to lightweight concrete. It turns into small micro cracks, distributed cracking, and then at a certain point, a crack will localize in the material. And even in a compression test that you do, remember that the failure of the material is always due to the tensile stress in the material. Because if you load vertically, horizontally, you get tensile stresses, and that's where a crack will happen, that's where your failure will start. Okay. That was the lecture. We'll have a small break now, and then after the break we can also have some questions about this, if you have. I also see some in the Q&A that I will answer. But also something to take for the project that you are working on, for the swimming pools. If you look at these pictures of the swimming pool, also there you see different type of damage. And try to explain why this damage happens, because that will determine what kind of repair or healing agent you are going to apply, or what part of the structure you're going to rebuild, if that's necessary. So for that you have to look at the damage that is there. So what causes this damage? What can you do about it? So take that with you when you study this project, and try to answer these questions on Friday. Okay, that's it for now. We have a break. Oh, it's already 10:08. Let's start at 10:25. Then we come back and we continue with the second part of the lecture, which will not be that long, so that will be okay. Okay, see you later.